Welcome to the second panel. I'm Anup Kumar, and this panel is on independent filmmaking. I'll first do the basic introductions, and then we will have some opening remarks from our panelists, and then maybe follow up with some questions, and then we will open it to the audience for your questions. So, starting from the left, we have Major Altieri. He has his film, A Beginner's Guide to Snuff at CIFF.
Yes.
It's going to be screened tonight at 11:20 and tomorrow at 4 p.m., so do check it out. Mitchell began his film career at the age of 19 when he wrote and directed the short film King's River, which earned him a Bay Area Cable Excellence Award. After that, he kind of drifted into advertising, but came back to film and made his first feature, Lurking in Suburbia. The film was discovered by Sundance senior programmer Trevor Groth, and which got a national release after that. Then he joined later on with Phil Flores to create The Butcher Brothers. The duo's first film was The Hamiltons, which won an award of the Santa Barbara and Malibu International Film Festival, and Lionsgate Films released that film. So, some of you might also know him from other films like The Halloween, The Texas Chainsaw Massacre, where they were connected with those films, those production of those films. The second on our panel from the left is Claire Carré, if I'm pronouncing it correctly. Claire is an alumna of Independent Filmmakers Projects Narrative Lab. She was nominated for the Gotham's Award Spotlight on Women's Director and won the Alice Gay Blasher Directing Award and Mary Shirley Award for Female Science Fiction Creators. She has a film, The Embers, and Embers at the CIFF. This film is going to be screened tonight at 7:45 and then tomorrow at 12:30. After that, we have our very own from Cleveland, Charles Moore. Charles Moore is from Lakewood, and I just came to know earlier today that he's a Cleveland State University graduate. So that's
Vikings. Woo!
Yeah. And Charles is an actor, producer, director. He also co-produced Catching Salinger, his film that screened in the local Heroes section. Madtown got quite a decent reception that the festival decided to have a third screening last night. And Charles has spoken, I read about Charles speaking in the press about independent filmmaking, and this one quote from him really spoke to me in terms of the challenges that independent filmmakers go through. He said, throughout this whole thing, I've had to keep in mind the idea that I'm just some guy from Cleveland that hasn't really done anything before. The key is to have a plan and a whole lot of enthusiasm.
I stole that quote from somebody else.
The next on our panel is Angela Tucker. Some of you might remember Angela Tucker. She was here in 2014 at CIFF. And Tucker is on the New Directions jury. And she's an Emmy-nominated producer, director, and writer. She directed hugely successful films like Asexual, Black Folks Don't, The New Black, which was screened in 2014 here at Cleveland. She's currently directing and producing Paper Chase, and has also founded a production company called Tucker Girl. And next to Tucker is Anna Rose Holmer. She's from Ohio, I guess.
Just shot here?
Okay, so she shot in Ohio. The filmmaker magazine named Anna Rose Holmer as 25 New Faces of Independent Film in 2015. Holmer is best known for work on Twilight, Tiny Furniture, and After School. Her film, The Fits, is screening here at the CIFF tonight at 9:40 and then tomorrow at 2:50 p.m. The Fits is Holmer's narrative directorial debut. So, with this introduction, I would like to just open this panel by asking you to make an opening remarks and sp- speak about some things, one single most important challenge that as an independent filmmaker you can talk about. Going back to your very, you know, first film, or even when you thought about making a film and thought of being an independent filmmaker. So why don't we start with you, Mitchell, over there?
Yeah. Hi. Thank you for the opening. I primarily do. I think I found my niche, I guess you'd call it, in independent horror movies. I like dark content and whatnot, and so it's something that I've been doing. I've done some studio stuff and got back, but it just independence kind of been my passion. Something difficult, it's all difficult. Filmmaking is a struggle from creating it. I write as well as directing and I'm involved in quite a bit of different aspects of producing movies. So I feel like it's all pretty hard. I think it's just kind of keeping the chaos together is like one of the most difficult things you can do in filmmaking. And I think we were just having the conversation earlier and trying to keep up with formats these days have been very difficult. You know, it's changing for the better. It's a lot more of a, you know, it's amazing how easy it is to, you know, make films now in a sense in formats where you can literally shoot something and put it onto a computer and just start cutting, where before it was a lot more difficult. But you know, kind of keeping up with this stuff, it's constantly changing as well. So that's one of the things that I was like, always kind of know what's happening, what formats are kind of going out and what's coming in, and kind of keeping up with that, I think is a very, very important thing. Cause you know, in a year, all the technology we have here is probably gonna be very different. So say technology.
I think that the most challenging part of, this is my first feature, making it was raising money. But I'm not gonna talk too much about that because the whole last panel was all about that. You guys were here. But I think one thing that I feel like something that's always challenging that I feel like I'm starting to get better at is time management on set. My background is doing music videos, and on a music video shoot, you have to shoot the whole thing usually in one 12-hour day. So I feel like having a background of being in set doing that, like so many times I've run out of time to do all the shots that I wanted, and so like I got the practical, the ones I needed to have of like the artist, but then the vibey ones that I wanted that made it like the most like me, I would run out of time to do at the end. So I think that I'm still working on it, but I'm getting better at figuring out how to maximize my time on set. And a big part of that is for me is trying to like pre-visualize the day, and like just even just stuff like if someone, especially if you're also producing your own thing, like where's the makeup person going to be set up, and where's the food going to be, and where are you going to put the generator that's not too noisy, and all that stuff. If you can kind of like figure out that stuff in advance, then when people are running up to you asking you about that stuff, you have a plan, and better yet, you've told everyone where to start their stuff, so they can just be, all the departments can be doing their own thing simultaneously, and they're not waiting for direction from you. So I think time management is always a challenge.
Hey, everybody. Claire used this interesting word, challenge. I used to use the word hard a lot, because filmmaking is, getting a film, you know, is a bit of a miracle that you know, once you do one, you realize how hard it is to go through the process. And I found that word hard turned a lot of people off. Mm-hmm. Using the word challenge, it became challenging to stop using the word hard. for me, you know, I think, you know, you meet a lot of filmmakers and we're all trying, how do you get these things off the ground? How do you get them accomplished? And you're always kind of looking into this future of who knows if it's even ever going to happen, right? Where's the finish? You know, there's no sense of a finish line, really. So, and that's where I struggled at first, trying to get stuff off the ground. Then it was like, okay, I really have to build a model around how this is going to be accomplished and work my way backwards. So it was really establishing the finish line and what I wanted to accomplish and then working my way backwards versus trying to look at it, you know, and from the finish line backwards versus looking into the abyss of nowhere. Now that's challenging to do, right? Because you know, you're small and you're independent and you don't have a lot of resources and you can't pick up the phone and make phone calls that would, you know, help you. But it's really, really important to, in my opinion, to establish that those building blocks, what you want to accomplish, and then stick to that. You know, you're going to get a million different reasons to, well, you do it this way, or I do that this way, this other way. I think when you start veering from that, you know, and especially if you believe in your plan, then it will fall apart and people will lose belief in you. When I did this film Madtown, it was like, this is what we're doing, and I never veered from it. Love or hate the movie, you know, how successful that it is or is not, that's how it got accomplished, by sticking to, you know, a finishing line that I wanted to get to. So, but it's just kind of putting that stick in the mud out there and then working your way backwards. That's, you know, challenging.
Everyone's saying all these things. I think it's sort of maintaining your drive to make projects. Sort of, I went from working at I worked at a production company for about 8 years called Big Mouth Productions. We made social issue documentaries, and I started out there as an intern, and then sort of moved my way up to director of production, and so I had like an infrastructure there. So the whole kind of the drive that you need to go from project to project was sort of set up because I worked at a company, and we were, and there was kind of a person making those decisions, and we were making movies together, but it was definitely like you had an infrastructure. And then once I left that and started working sort of in a more freelance capacity on different projects so that I could do a little more directing, that's when I sort of saw just kind of how much drive it takes to have an idea for a project, see it through, make it, move on to the next thing. It just takes so much kind of focus and drive, and you just have to kind of keep reminding yourself, like, okay, why are you making this project? What do you want to get out of it, both like creatively and just, you know, why are you doing it? And that's something that, because I mean, I've struggled with all of the things, but I think recently it's been like, okay, as you sort of take on a new project, you're like, okay, we're taking on this new project, like I'm producing a new film that's shooting now. And when I was said yes to it, I'd sit down and say, okay, like, why am I taking on this new project that's going to be like 4 years of no money? But I had to, you know, like, remember, okay, this is a topic that I'm really committed to, and blah, blah, blah. So I think that's lately what's been on my mind, is just sort of maintaining drive and feeling like I'm working towards the kind of projects that I want to make.
Hey, I'm Anna. So I came up actually in the camera department, very traditionally in film, like as a loader first, operator, DP, and then I transitioned into producing and did that for a while, and this is my first directorial fiction feature. I also produced on it, so I've had a lot of different roles, and I think one of the things that I've learned a lot is just about, and is a constant challenge, I think, is curating your own style of creative leadership and being a leader that crews want to work for, who enjoy being on your set, and have that kind of enthusiasm can translate into content on screen. And I think I've learned a lot of that through creative, like, mentors that I've had that are creative producers, more so than directors, actually, because creative producers, like, have that idea of curating a team, and you're kind of like the coach and the cheerleader at the same time. And for me, with this feature, one of the things that I'm most proud about, and we spent so much time talking about, was the tone of our set and what we wanted to do now that we were in charge. And I think that as an independent filmmaker, there's a luxury, you're running your set, but there's a responsibility to setting a tone of what every day is gonna be like, and there's no boss above you. That's freeing and it's terrifying. But I think for me, the biggest challenge is saying, like, okay, how do I want my PA to talk about the movie, like, a year from now, what that experience is like? Mm-hmm. And that's important because that person is gonna, like, finance your movie like 10 years from now, you know what I mean? Like, this is a community, and like, there's this really social aspect of it, and it's not just about, like, you know, the self game, but really making us, for me, it was really important to have a set that felt like how I wanted to be treated when I was a crew member, and that was, like, sometimes that went against creative decisions, and you have to balance that. And it's not always like being a nice person, that's not what I'm talking about, but being a leader that kind of asks people to give insane amounts of themselves to you for your project. You really have to come up with a reason why you're doing it, so you can translate that to other people. And so that's kind of a constant thing that I'm in dialogue with myself about.
Yeah.
taking off on what Anna said about organization, I was reading about independent filmmaking in the local papers, and one of our professors was quoted as saying, you know, that who's also an independent filmmaker, he said that it's not just about selling a story. You have to convince people that this can be done. This is a possible, you know, this is, you can make this film. And then put together a team, the people who believe in the project, and they are ready to work for it, sometimes even for less money, that they're going to, you're going to bring them together. So how much important is that, you know? Just, could you speak a little bit more about the team and how do you build that team and organization? You have to convince other people.
I think it does come from like inviting people to be authors alongside with you, alongside of, you know, there is a director top-down model and that works in some cases, but I also think like it's really valuable if your DP is saying like, this is my work, this is my film, and kind of from the ground up asking people to collaborate, not just do their job. And that's like fine-tuned stuff, but when you find somebody who challenges you, pushes you, like subverts your own idea about your content, like hold them tight, treat them fairly, respect them, and because like this is a collaborative art form, and like that's, it's so rare, those little connections, and you have to foster those relationships and empower those people, you know. My co-writer on my film was also my editor. She just directed a short film that I produced, and it's like we give each other what we need for different projects, and I think that's really important in the independent space, is to be really generous. And yeah, but when you find that person, be like, tell them how meaningful it is to work with them, vocalize it. It's important to hear that you're valued, and I don't know.
Yeah, it is somewhat what, it's not a top-down model, and there is a lot of collaboration, and there is also this generosity that you have to have towards your other artists that are along with you. Angela, you work with companies, and then you start your own independent. So how do you see that?
Yeah, I 100% with everything that Anna's saying. I mean, you know, I and I think everyone up here is, we're working in a space where, you know, we're not really paying people, no one's doing it for the money. They're doing it for kind of the love of the material or just a connection that they have with you or something like that. So I think it is extremely important to treat people with respect. And I think that, you know, there's this funny sort of idea of film. I think it's like, I don't know how it's been perpetuated through like movies or whatever, but it's like the crazy director who's on top and they're in control and everyone is like scurrying around them, and you know, and it's like, no, that's not how it works. Especially when, you know, you're asking, I'm crewing up for I've been working in the documentary space for years, and I'm crewing up for my first fiction feature that I'm shooting in June. And you know, it's just, it's a tremendous thing that you're asking people, that you're like, hey, for a month, make basically a fraction of what you usually make, work really, really long hours, and but it's gonna be fun, you know? And I think it's important to work with people who can help make your project better and that have ownership. I think ownership is incredibly important, and it's not like, you know, everyone knows that you're the director, that there's a writer, whatever, but it's important that everybody, you know, everyone who's in the film, everyone who's participating in it, feels a part of it, because then they're just gonna be working harder to make it better. And you don't know where good ideas come from. Good ideas come from like the craziest places. Like, you know, I'm also making a film that has a bunch of young teenagers in them. And like, you know, I mean, they're gonna come up with lines that like, I mean, I'm not a teenager. We wrote this script, but like, there are things I know in it that are not what teenagers say. And I want them, just like, I'm totally gonna be like, say that how you say it. I don't know. I don't know what says dope anymore. So like, find a new word, you know? But, and then that sort of creates like a space that people want to be in. But I think it's really important. And I also try to, I sort of mix working on like branded content, so like, you know, commercials for Coke and stuff. So I try to like hire people to work on that stuff too, so that there's like a balance of like, hey, I'm paying you like a lot of money on this thing,
and now can you come work on this other thing? So like my DP now I've been working with for like a couple of years, and we just like, we're working on this Coke thing together, and then we'll make this movie, and then, you know, and so then that way too, you're like, I feel like in that way I'm able to acknowledge, like, I know what your value is in this space. I'm trying to honor that value. But also, like, we want to make lots of different kinds of work together, so let's find a way to make that work. I think if that's ever possible, I try to do that too.
Mitchell, could you speak to that in terms of differences between working with a company and then as an independent filmmaker?
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. I mean, that if you're going to make a film, you know, especially in the independent space, you know, respect is a really big thing, and treating your crew, you know, surrounding yourself with really good people is important, and treating them well, and keeping the ones that are very valuable, keeping them around, because, you know, the people that are, you know, very talented, so they kind of tend to get jobs and disappear very quickly. But just in saying, what, you know, I did a studio film out in North Carolina, and an opposite of an independent set. You know, this was like a 150-man crew, all union, you know, Teamsters, electricity, I mean, trucks and everything, was the whole nine yards. And I was doing this film with my filmmaking partner, Phil, who, you know, we're known as the Butcher Brothers, and we kind of noticed, especially like the electricians and the grips, like they were really standoffish, and like they went like, and they were like almost just downright mean. And we're like, what's going on? Like, you know, they just were not just nice. And they, these guys were like pretty much bikers. I mean, they were tatted down and just, you know, but we're like, why? You know, they're just like, they were really, and one of our actors who we've worked with quite a bit, he makes, every time we do a film, he'll kind of make it a point to, when you're sitting in the, you know, in the mess hall, basically, you could, like, he'll sit with different groups and like he'll like have lunch with them, and that's what he does. And he sat with this group, and you know, the with the electricians, and they were just like, they just didn't say a word to him. They were really, and so finally they did have like a chili cook-off, you know, it was like on our day off, and we showed up, and then I finally started talking to like kind of their main guy, and he's like, yeah, he's like, you know, these, he was a lot of LA, this is like when North Carolina was a really hot spot for filming, and he's like, you know, a lot of people, you know, a lot of the execs and people from LA come here, and they treat us just like dog shit, basically. Like, and so we've kind of grown this thick skin, and so we really, and we're like, hey, we're not these, you know, we came up in the indie world, like, you know, this is something that we, you know, we value everybody, and I think once they saw that and we started treating them with respect, it came back to the point where I got into an argument with one of the execs, and this one guy was like, do you want me to go take care of that guy for you? I'm like, no, no, we're all good. But that's how, even on that level of like, you know, these union Teamsters, where they, you know, if you treat them with respect, you know, and these guys are getting top dollar, but it was still something that they, you know, they really appreciate it. And, you know, I have friends for life there, you know, and if I'm going to shoot there, it's like something to have. So, 100%. And it goes, but, you know, and, you know, when you're doing indie films, it's kind of the same thing. You know, I have a rule on set where it's like anybody can bring, you know, they have a suggestion or something, like from a PA to anybody can, you know, there's a specific time to bring it up. It's not like during a take can somebody go and talk to an actor and give them an idea that they have. But, you know, I feel that it's very important. They're, you know, that whole thing of just, as you explained, like the director running around, I've seen that. Mm-hmm. On set where, you know, directors are like screaming and they have like, you know, their entourage of 20 people, and that's just a factory, and great if that's your style, you know, but that's just something that they're just turning stuff out, and usually it's just something really big. But I think, you know, nowadays you're starting to see that filmmaking is an art form. And the thing I've learned, where when I started out, I thought that I had to know everything and do everything and just be touch everything, and then finally I just like started getting older and getting more tired, and my back started to hurt, and I'm like, you know what, you surround yourself with really good people, and that's the most important thing. You know, you have like the good DP, you have a really good producer, a great assistant, right? Like you surround yourself, and you start realizing, really let them do what they do. It's a challenge sometimes on independent films, because sometimes you're not getting the best crew members, you know, but for the most part, if you really surround yourself with like specific crew members, like you can really realize that you can get a lot of stuff. And you know, be comfortable with allowing talented people to kind of take over and do their thing. Like, you know, like with actors, like they're gonna say, you know, like I had a script where I was writing something where it was like, you know, like teenage girls, and they're like, you are just not, you cannot write for this. Like, you, let us read it, you know. So, I think that's, you know, respect and also allowing, you know, your talented, you don't, as a director, you want to control everything, but, you know, or being, you know, a director or a producer, but you got to allow your, you know, the talented people that you hire, that you surround yourself with, to really do their job as well.
Charles, what do you say? Your experience as an actor on you know, both independent films and...
Yeah, you know, I came up just doing just about, you know, right. Being from Cleveland, you do anything and everything to be involved. So I'm an actor by trade, but then I got into production, and I PA'd, and I worked in sound, and I AD'd, and I got into producing. So I really, you know, just any opportunity that I could get, I would take advantage of it kind of because I had to. But the reoccurring thing that you're hearing up here is, you know, be good to people, right? Treat them well. And then how does that translate into organization and set, right? That's what we're trying to do here. So, you know, vetted, experienced people who work on, you know, who make a career of this and know what they're doing, especially in your key department heads, your ADs, your cinematographer, okay, production designer, you know, they're so critical to have and have them on your team. And all of these great folks, talented folks up here have earned that, you know, you earn that credibility. It just doesn't come day one. You know, you might get lucky, but the reality is people will get to know you, they'll see your work ethic and how you treat other people. And that is relationship building 101. And we all, I think out of the gate, you want to get out, you want to be shooting, and you don't know what you don't know. And then you hire somebody, you can hire somebody and you could love them to death and they can love you to death, but they're, quite frankly, they're not prepared to do that job yet. And you weren't prepared to even hire them to do that job yet. Right? So it's relationship building 101. It's, you know, learning what all the different departments do, being able to, especially in independent filmmaking, secure key department heads to come, and then, you know, and even if below them they're a little not quite there yet, you know, they can really lift up a department, you know, if you have the right person. So, but that just takes, you know, relationship building like anything. And there's a lot of that in filmmaking. We want to get to shoot, let's get making this, let's, you know, but it just doesn't really happen that way, usually. It takes time.
The relationships, some of the relationships in independent filmmaking are personal. You, unlike an organizing company, studio you're working for. Claire, you're talking about time management. Then how does that time management fit into, because personal relationships, you see how it might work out when you say, well, we have to be at the set at this time, and somebody, you know, you're giving a command to a friend also at the same time. How do you manage that time where people work and, you know, and that personal relationships come in between?
Well, I mean, I think for me, a lot of the sort of key positions on my film were people that I had worked with for a long time on shorter projects, on music videos, on fashion films. So we already had like a shorthand of working with each other where we trusted each other, where I could kind of say something, and like since we'd worked on a bunch of stuff before, they know what I'm talking about. Or like, oh, let's do like a setup like we did on that thing. Or like, oh, you know, the thing, I can't remember the name, like, you know what I'm talking about, like, and they know what you're talking about. I think also one thing that was for me really great working with, side note, is that we shot our film in three different cities, so we had three different crews, and only the key crew members, like myself, my co-writer and co-producer, our DP and production designer, were the only ones that were at every shoot, and the rest was different. But because we were sort of like the head people, we did set the tone of how we wanted the set to roll and what our kind of like style was. So I think that it, you know, and we were all friends and felt comfortable working with each other and had like we had the same vision of what the film should be. And I think for me, working with you know, collaborators that I trusted, like sometimes we, you know, I, being the director and a producer, I felt like a lot of responsibility to everyone who was there and to them. And sometimes I would feel like, oh, you know, like we just gotta like move on, like I don't think we can do this. And if it was, you know, I think because they shared a vision with me, they could stand up and say like, no, we have to get this shot, like, yeah. You, because I would feel like, you know, for this, sometimes for their benefit, like I didn't want to like push them to do more, and they'd be like, no, like I want to, because we need this for the film. And I think that they felt comfortable, you know, with me to to say that and stand up for like creative aspects that they believed in.
As an independent film producer, how do you, you know, there are deal with when you when you're in a city and it's a state where the unions are there and there is, you know, how do you handle that, especially with a smaller budget that you work with in the same process, because there are, you know, rates that you have to pay, which is already decided by the guild and other people in the process. For example, Mitchell, how do you do that in terms of, do you face that as a producer, that becomes a bigger challenge?
I mean, I think we all know it's all a, you know, it's a challenge. I mean, basically, it's like the size of your budget. You know, if you're showing up to a city with a $10 million budget, all the unions are going to go, what's going on? What's happening? We want to know what's up. I mean, you know, and unless you're in a right-to-work state, you know, it's something that you're going to have to deal with. Now, if you're going to show up with, you know, a couple hundred thousand, you don't necessarily need, you know, to have the unions. I mean, you're going to have to do SAG, but they have... What is it, the low modified? So I think it's just kind of that. I mean, obviously it's up to, you know, to the production, but it's usually when you're doing a smaller production, you're not going to, you just can't afford to do a union, you know, shoot. So it's, and they're usually okay with, you know, as long as your budget's kind of low, they're okay. You know, you will hear, you know, stories where a production shooting and they're kind of in that weird range, like $1 to $2 million, and they get flipped. And that means literally the unions will come in and they'll picket the production, and until they sign all the, you know, the union contracts and whatnot, you know, and that will, a budget of like, let's say 1.5 will go to like almost $5 million. And it's a reality. So most of the time is that, you know, what we usually do is like we kind of contact people and kind of let people know like, hey, we're here. I shot a movie and in Maryland just about 6-7 months ago, and we contacted the union. I'm not saying, you know, I'm not sure if you want to contact the union sometime. I'm not sure, but we did. And we just said, hey, we're here. And they actually were very helpful. They said, you know, it was small enough where they were like, you know, I mean, it was still, I mean, we're close to $1 million, but they were kind of like, here, you know, here's some people. They even sent some of their guys over that were out of work, and they're like, hey, hire them. So, you know, it's kind of it's a little bit of a balance, but, you know, the hard thing is if you ever get flipped, that's really, really tough. But if you have a low enough budget, you're kind of safely under the radar. And in my opinion, this is a kind of a delicate matter.
Yeah, anybody else has an experience about that?
I worked on both as well in different capacities. This film, The Fits, was a micro budget by anybody looking at it, and we shot in Ohio. We did contact the film commission, let them know, and like people were like, did you leave off like a zero by, or like two zeros by any chance in your budget? So like nobody had a question about it. But I think in instances where it's been close, I personally feel like it's much better if there's gonna be an issue to know about it ahead of time, and to have time to talk about it when that's not a day on set where you're paying people and there's stress and tears and things like actors' schedules. If you know that union is gonna have an issue, it's better to know about that ahead of time. And usually they're understanding. It is that kind of gray area, but it does jump quite a bit. But I would say there are besides budget, you know, the union does regulate quite a bit of set activity, and no matter what set I'm on, we follow union laws, and that's out of respect for people's, like, when they eat, how long they go between meals, like, how you deal with overtime.
100%.
We follow those rules because it's
workers'
fair.
Workers' compensation.
Yeah,
and
it's like, and insurance, and, like, so it doesn't matter if I'm saying, like, hey, take a pay cut, be on my set, I'm still going to follow what's fair laws, and also in terms of, like, you know, there are different laws for every single state, not just union, but in terms of like hours and if you're working with minors and if you're working with SAG. And like, so having, like, I always recommend it, hiring, even if you have production counsel, hiring a labor lawyer from the state, even if it's to consult for a few hours to talk about maybe potentially something that could work in your benefit or a law you didn't know about, or if you have minors, are you even allowed to shoot during a school day? Yeah. Like, there are different laws. And so I recommend bringing on a labor lawyer. It's a little bit of money up front, but legal counsel is so specific to state laws. There are some national laws, But yeah, I would say my biggest advice is no matter if you're doing union or non-union, understand those laws, why they're important to crew members. And yeah, we follow union regulation, even if we're not paying people kind of their set rate, because I think it is important, and like crews all over the country agree that that's how they want to work on set. So kind of going back to respect, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Because it also, like, you know, following those laws, it's absolutely true. And it, as we know, like what happened with the tragedy, you know, like actually saves lives too.
Yeah,
you know,
agree.
Where, you know, Sarah, you know, got hit by the train. It's like horrible stuff. And that's like, you're not following rules, regardless of your union or not, you got to follow those laws. Like,
yeah.
There's a lot of layers to this, you know, this part of it. And the truth is, it's a little gray when you go into it. You know, if you're an Indian, you're in that unknown zone. A lot of people actually get into the union because they were non-union working on a set that gets flipped. How do I know? That's how I got in the union. The first thing I worked on was, was a $1.5 million budget or so that ended up getting flipped. And there's the producer's side of why they believe it got flipped. There's the union side.
Sure,
there are all
sure,
these
sure.
different stories on ultimately why it happened. And you can even go in advance and approach the union and say, you know, you're looking to get that waiver, quote unquote waiver, that says, you know, have fun making a movie. But the reality is they're not contractually writing you something that says, okay, we're never going to come touch you. So you get 1 week in and you're treating everybody like crap and you're violating all these normal operating procedures. They
yeah.
will come and they will flip you even though
yeah.
they said have fun making a movie. So you have to, you know, you have to be true and to it the whole journey. And, you know, and then there's sometimes there might be, and this is weird to say, but some crew people are trying to get in the union, right? You know,
sure.
I've seen movies where, you know, false problems emerge that aren't really
absolutely.
A real thing, right? Because there's these hidden agendas. So, you know, a lot of times these non-union films are looking to hire, quite frankly, union people, but not necessarily being
yeah.
union. No. But it's weird even talking about it because it's a little.
As I think everybody's saying here, it's a gray kind of
yeah.
touchy little thing. But it's.
But it's something you got to talk about that model. You know, working your way backwards. That's something you have to count into that. You know, so
yeah.
when I look at something that's kind of in that realm, you go, hey, if this is union, it's going to be this. If it's going to end up non-union, it's going to be this. You got to measure the temperature and culture, what's going on in the city that you might potentially shoot in that moment.
Yeah,
because you're coming off of another movie that just shot and there was a bad experience there, and no matter how organized you are, there's a residual taste in their mouth from the previous production. So there's a lot of unpredictables that you could
yeah.
run into. That's why it's so gray. That's what makes it so challenging.
So think about filmmaking at two ends. One is the idea where it starts, and the other end where it's distribution, that everybody gets to see what your idea was, right? And then there is the whole process in between, where from idea to distribution. How important do you think are these two ends for an independent producer to really seriously, you know, work through it? One is the idea itself. How compelling is the idea that you think that, yeah, this is worth making, yeah, this people would like? And then how compelling is to think about, even at the very beginning stage, about that end process, which is the distribution? Anybody would like to?
So because I started out in documentary, it's interesting because I actually started out as sort of when I was interning. I interned on this film called Outside Looking In, which was about like transracial adoption, and I had just graduated, and they were looking to just do college and university screenings, and it was like, now there's a lot of like mechanisms and infrastructure to do that, but at that point that movie had no money, and they were like, just set up some screenings that you were just in college, set up screenings at colleges. And I was like, okay. And so that was an interesting sort of introduction into, like, this film had a PBS broadcast, but it, you know, it had like a soft, like, I forgot what it, God, there's a term basically where it's on PBS, it's not on a strand, so you kind of have to catch it. So, you know, like those movies that come on at like 2 a.m. and you're like, what's this? It was like one of those movies. So, like, you just felt like no one really, not that many people really saw it, right? So, you know, I just kind of reached out to different, you know, presidents of student organizations because I knew they always had money, and we just kind of set up our own tour in terms of wanting to show the film in sort of multiracial student organizations. And so that was sort of my introduction into this audience engagement world, which now has really, you know, become a really important part of documentary distribution specifically. But what I learned from that experience working with that filmmaker was, you know, he really knew the audience that he wanted to see that film. He was like, yeah, sure, yes, you want a lot of people to see your movie, but he also was like, there's a community of people who adopt, there's a community of people who were adopted, and then there's also the community of various sort of multiracial people who have been adopted who don't really see those themselves and see those stories. So him having that really specific vision of where he wanted, like, that community and finding ways to reach out to that community, not just through screenings, but we showed at conferences and you know, and that was how we generated sort of sales for the film. That I've sort of carried that methodology throughout in terms of even in the, so even with, like, you know, starting to make fiction films, it's thinking, okay, who is the community that I really want to see this film? How can we get it to them? And sure, it's great if, like, distributors come on board, both, you know, small and large, but I think it's really important to just, in the very beginning, think about who are the people that you want to see this film, and in the most specific a way as possible, not just, like, everybody, you know? So yeah, I think that's really where I kind of actually begin when I'm thinking of something, or just, like, even as a director or as a producer, it's like, okay, what is that community? Because it also helps you focus the vision of the film, too.
I would say, like, a similar but a little different. As a producer, and then I had this conversation with myself, but one of the first things that I do when I meet with someone and we're talking about a project, I say, well, in a best case scenario, how would you define success for this project? Mm-hmm. It's like super cheesy, whatever kind of thing, define success for yourself, but it's important to know what the goals are. Mm-hmm. Sometimes that means getting your work seen by X audience, mm-hmm. enacting social change, kind of having that it's just about production and getting to experiment with this creative idea, mm-hmm. and that's the success model.
Right.
Sometimes it's, I want to get awards so that it's easier to finance my next project,
mm-hmm.
or, you know, with the fits, for me as a director, is I want to make a second film, so we often were making decisions not about, like, earning, you know, making financial decisions with a distribution model, but getting it seen by as many people, focus on press, because press is helpful when we're going to package for our second film. So I think understanding not just audience, but how you kind of want your life as a film to be, because that makes different, that kind of causes a ripple effect all the way back to prep,
yeah.
You know, and sometimes it is, it's like, I have this creative itch, I wanna try CG.
Mm-hmm.
So the whole project is about experimenting that and having the first taste. Maybe that means you're not making a feature, maybe that means you're making a short. So, like, that's a huge difference in what you're doing, and if that's all this experiment is really about, or if it's like, I want, like, 7-year-old girls all over the film, all over the world to, like, have a different idea about themselves, and, like, then you're talking about mainstream broadcast and distribution. So you need, maybe your script needs to be a little more commercial. So, and that's at the script phase. That's not something you're dealing with when you're selling at the festival. So many things, I think, in terms of, like, reaching those goals are about prep and development phase. So I think it's important,
yeah,
to have those conversations.
Totally,
and if your producer and directing team are not on the same page about what the goals are, like, that's,
yeah,
where the trouble is.
The management
totally,
of expectations
totally.
Is so important, and I think obviously there's the creative and there's the business side of it. You know, creatively, what are we trying to accomplish? Play some festivals, you know, I'm trying to, you know, change, you know, the way people look at something, and I think that's, you know, that's really subjective. It can be very subjective, right? And then there's the dollars and cents, because production's expensive, and even when you're making micro-budget films, you know, these are, you could put a kid through college on,
yeah,
the amount of money you spend on making a micro-budget film. So the management of those two combined expectations and what that end goal is and what you're trying to accomplish, and getting everybody, especially in your management staff, on the same page and really believing that we're all on the same,
yeah,
page, you know, doubling back, let's meet tomorrow in 15 minutes and say that again, document it. You know, it's very important. And
I mean, I think one thing that's exciting about being a sort of emerging filmmaker right now is that the means to make your film and the means to get your film seen are, like, more open to everyone than they ever have been. Like, you know, like, last year, like, Tangerine was shot famously, like, the whole film was shot on an iPhone, and it's And that's like the first thing you hear about it, but what makes it a success is that it's actually a really good movie. You know, with great performances and good directions. And so like how it was shot is, you know, it's not getting in the way of the story. And now, you know, through, you know, there's iTunes, there's Vimeo, there's, you know, there's things like VHX and Distribute, and there's a lot of ways to, a lot of, more and more people are watching things on digital platforms and streaming from home. I mean, I live kind of in the country in upstate New York, and like that's how I watch almost everything, is I watch it streaming. And I think there's a, that's the case for a lot of people. And it doesn't, you can make a film and you can get it released. I think going back to Angela's point is like, say it's somewhere on iTunes, like no one will know that unless you are reaching your audience and they know to where, how to find your, that your film even exists and how to find your, how you find your film and watch it.
How important is a festival for, in that process, to be in a festival like, you know, like we have, you are here at Lumet in Cleveland, for that process where you think about the audience, you think about your distribution, think about that?
I had a really interesting thing with FITS. So we got a grant from the Venice Biennale, which is an art institute, and part of the grant was we knew from the script phase that we were going to premiere at Venice. And that currency, and Venice is an incredible festival, but that currency at every stage was just like, even on our crew, it was like, you're not just making a film now for an abstract maybe audience as an independent film, it's like a definitely like an audience is gonna see that. But I do think that, like, I think it depends on where, again, what your goals are. If you're trying to attract a sales agent and make a kind of more traditional sale, then I think festival premiere and festival launch is still currently an important factor in the kind of business potential of your film. That may not be your goal. Self-distribution is a reality, and actually, I know a lot of people who profit more significantly than going with a major distributor. So they're like, those are questions that you can ask, and maybe that means, you know, a different festival life. But for, I still think currently as is, festivals are hugely important for also like knowing how your film is going to play for a room, like, and how that changes from region to region. It's so exciting to be part of that, because once it's, if you do sell and you're in theaters, that kind of connection to your audience isn't even really part of that. It's at festivals where you get to have these beautiful conversations with people, and there's really special, I think, it teaches you a lot about your films.
Mitchell, about this festival, right?
It's 100%, I mean, I've done quite, you know, I've done a lot of film festivals, everything from South By to Sundance and everything, and it's at, I think, just what everybody's saying here, it really is, the landscape of independent films has changed quite a bit. You know, the time, and it's a good thing, but you know, but there was the time where, you know, Tarantino and Rodriguez and all those guys were, you know, you would make a movie and the only outlet was to, you know, was for the Weinsteins to buy it and put it into a theater, and then you had a choice. I can watch a studio movie, or I had one or two options of an independent film. That is no more. Now there's, you know, you just go on iTunes or you go on demand, and it's, you know, it's kind of overwhelming. You know, like that's why you start your movie with like an A or B, because you can find it, like, you know, quickly. But that's really kind of, you know, people are like,
it's a real
studio
thing.
Like studios like you'll start noticing that movies are starting with A's and B's.
Exactly. You know?
But it's exciting and the same thing. But it goes to what everybody here is saying is very important. Like now more than ever, you know, when in the 90s, when everybody, you know, when these guys were doing independent films, they were just doing something, you know, they're like, okay, we're gonna put this together, and then who sees it's gonna see it, and this is how it goes. But now it's, you really have to have an idea behind it, and you gotta know where your audience is gonna be and where it's gonna live. It is important, which is, it's exciting, because you do get to, you know, people get to see your movie, but it does take a little bit more work and you know, pre-planning. And the festivals do come into it where it's really important. It's, you know, a testing ground. You know, I had a movie at Sundance that, when we were done screening, I was like, oh my God, we really need to get back and re-edit this thing. It just wasn't ready, you know, and it happens. And we spent almost, you know, 4 months, you know, in post again with it. But it, even though the landscape has changed, it's like that, it festivals still kind of are the number one place to get your film seen, where buyers can see your movie, where interest, word of mouth is very important. You know, you're going to get your reviews, and for an independent filmmaker, you know, festivals kind of your best friend. You know, and the more festivals that you go, like, festivals are really great. You know, with alumni, usually if you do, you know, shoot at a festival, it's always, you know, like if I have a film, like festivals will contact me and say, hey, what's going on with this film or not? And you know, they're very friendly with that, because they do want, you know, they're kind of, as much as you as a filmmaker want to get into a festival, festivals actually want you to come back and actually show your film. They, you know, they want it just as much. So I think it's an important relationship. It goes again back to relationships. And for independent filmmakers, I would say, like, you know, festivals are great friends, you know.
Well, and there's so many, because everyone kind of has access to make films, there's so many films being made now, and festivals act as a kind of like curatorial voice, where it's like, oh, well, Sundance or South by Southwest or Cleveland, like the programming team saw thousands of films and they picked these ones that they are sort of choosing as like, these are what we want to represent the festival. And so by getting accepted to a festival, you have been, you know, selected out of many, and you get, I think that gives you, you know, I think that helps when your film eventually comes out, that people have heard of it, because the festivals are also, they're putting you in the book, and they're doing press, and they're doing panels, and they're trying to support the films that they've chosen.
Yeah, and it's thousands, I mean, absolutely, yeah, right, like thousands and thousands of
movies. And there's also really amazing, beautiful, like, well-crafted, smart, necessary films that don't get into festivals.
Yes, absolutely. Every day. Yeah.
And like, being on the receiving end of a rejection is just as important. And I think you have to say, like, when you get accepted, there's something there, but I think you have to always think about, like, there's a tone, or you're part of a program, and there's things that have nothing to do with your film. And I think when you get accepted, to also remember that it's because, yeah, like, films fall through the cracks, that's our business, and it's not always that, like, magic wand pointing and saying, you're legit, you know? So I think just to also say, like, I've seen amazing films that don't get out there, and, like, that happens too, and that doesn't necessarily mean that content is any less deserving of an audience. It's just that moment, and there's a lot of things that go into festival curation that isn't actually about you, so.
I mean, I've gotten,
there's a lot of slotting in politics. There's a lot of slotting in politics, especially at the tier of the bigger film festivals, you know, and that's just the reality of it. There's a lot at stake. The marketing of getting those laurels on your, you know, help careers, help next pictures get off the ground. And a lot of those films are fantastic, too. Yeah. They're fantastic, you know, and then there's other ones you go, well, this, you know, this took a slot maybe away from somebody else, but that's a little icky part of that side of it, but get used to that in the film world. You know, you're going to run into that just at about every stage. Just a practical, you know, thing, like with our film, we had, you know, there's these film markets too. You have American Film Market in Cannes, and you can take, you know, and then it's your traditional go with the sales agent, and they're selling territories and everything. So we had the opportunity. A number of people that wanted to take us to Berlin, mainly, never even hate the film, it's because, you know, the face recognition value of somebody who's in your film and what they've been in before, they go, oh, we can sell this in the territory, this, that, the other thing. But we chose to, but we didn't have a lot of leverage outside of, we just finished the film. We didn't have any laurels on it yet. I wanted to do a festival run. I wanted to get the opportunity to meet that whole relationship building, you know, go on that year and just build up that credibility, hopefully. You know, it's a little bit of a risk, but get out there and play. So we leave from here, then we go to USA Film Festival, which I'm a huge fan of. We go out to Newport, which I'm a huge fan of. So, and then on from there. So so I felt, well, you know, if you're patient, you have that extra 6 months and fight hard for those, it might, you know, you might have a little bit more leverage. We'll come around November the next time, you know. But you have to have the time and space to be able to do that also.
Yes.
And which is another part of putting that, you know, working your way backwards, you know, what do I want to do when I get there? Am I willing to put in a whole nother year of this journey? And can I even do it, you know, financially and emotionally? Can I do it?
The emotional.
Yeah, especially the emotional part.
Yeah. I just want to say one fast thing, which is so I directed a documentary called Asexual, and it's about people experiencing no sexual attraction, and it's kind of this growing movement, and it's on Netflix and stuff like that. And But how it ties to the festival part of it is, you know, I made that film and I was like, oh my God, that movie, it's going to premiere at South by Southwest. That's what I want for myself. That's when it's going to happen. And then I did not get into South by Southwest and I was devastated. And I was like, that's the path. That's the journey of that movie. And I just had no, like, and because I had worked on other films that had premiered at certain festivals, I was like, oh, well, that's going to happen with this one. And when it didn't happen, I had to like take a second and like reevaluate and say, okay, what's next? Like, what's the next festival, what makes sense, what journey does this movie need to be on? And I just had some friends of mine who are filmmakers and also sort of like tastemakers and who have been to a lot of festivals just like watch the cut and say, okay, like this is where I'm at. And it was really interesting in that process, in that I just had a friend who was, the asexual community really wants to be a part of the LGBT community, and that's a storyline in the film in terms of wanting acceptance there. And it never really dawned on me. My friend was like, you should just apply to Frameline. It's like the biggest LGBT film festival in the world. People from all over the world who program LGBT film festivals go to that festival. I had never heard of Frameline. I was like, what? I never thought of my film as like an LGBT film. Like, that was a big storyline in the movie. And we applied to Frameline and we got in. And that was a really important learning moment for me in terms of like, you think you understand what your movie is about because you've been making it all this time, but sometimes your movie kind of organically becomes something else because you're following a storyline. And it was like, oh, and that is the best thing that could have happened in that film. We screened at like 50 LGBT film festivals. I traveled all over the world. Never would have thought that that was the journey of that film. And I say that because it's really easy to get in sort of the film festival rat race and sort of want certain, think that certain places are gonna, you know, be where your film needs to go. And like on every, in making that film, every like broadcaster that I went to weren't the right broadcasters. And then finally we were on Pivot recently. And so it's just like, you have to kind of, once you make the film, there is that journey of understanding what your film is. And sometimes festivals can help you kind of figure that out and know how to like take it where it needs to go.
Let's open it to audience questions. Would like to go first? Yes, ma'am, you in the middle over there?
Oh, yeah. I have a question for Mitchell. I was intrigued by the movie that you said screened at Sundance, and you said you had to go back into post-production because it wasn't ready. So what made you know it wasn't ready? I mean, I'm assuming that you wouldn't put it at Sundance if you thought after the first time that it wasn't ready, that you did think it was ready, and then what happened that made you realize it wasn't ready?
So we weren't sure it was ready. So when we were editing the movie, and the Sundance thing was kind of a very strange experience for me, because we were editing the movie, and it was in shambles. You know, we didn't even have the third act put together, and we had like over 100 hours worth of footage. And so anyway, long story short, I told the producer, I said, we're not even going to submit to Sundance. I go, let's strive for South by Southwest. It gives us a little bit more time. But the programmer, who has known my work, Trevor, who was, had heard that we had shot this movie, and he called me and was like, hey, I had heard that you got this movie. And I told him, I said, look, I don't think it's going to be ready. And he's like, well, he goes, I just need to see it. Like, he goes, I just want to do my due diligence. He sent, I go, there's not even a third act. So we sent the movie for submission for him with the assembly cut of the first two acts, and the third act was just photographs. I'm not kidding you, not with like text under it. And he's like, look, if you can get it ready, and this is in November, he's like, if you can have it ready in January, he's like, we'd love to see it, or we'd love to have it here, like invitation. We had five editors working around the clock. Our
so stressful.
It really was.
We could just know.
We never stopped production or post-production. It was just cutting. And we literally sent it a day before our screening, and it came on, and 2 minutes into it, I was like, Jesus Christ, we should have said no. Like, it was this bad. And it just wasn't ready. And that's what happened. So we went back, and then we hired, at the time, had the same manager as Rob Zombie, and we brought in Rob's editor, and he spent, like, we already had, like, five guys working, and we just said, okay, like, let's just give it to Rob's guy, and he's gonna, and he cut it and redid it, and then we were, you know, we were very happy with it. But that was the experience. But so there is something to say, like, there is a choice to be made. Like, you know, you're gonna, if you do have an opportunity to screen at a festival, you know, it is, but sometimes it may not work. Like for us, it didn't work in our benefit. You know, it was like we, you know, the film industry is already such enough to get ready for a roller coaster. I mean, anybody here can tell you, like, 1 minute, like at Sundance, I remember just having, like, we had a photograph. We got attached and got our movie. Our next movie was called Black Sunset. That was, you know, it was financed, and we were like in like this big spread on the Hollywood Reporter. And I was like, my God, life is so great for me, and I'm at Sundance, look at me, I'm the king of the world. And then the next day, like, the review of my movie came out, and it was just like, this guy should, like, go bury his head in the sand and just disappear. And I was like, well, it'd be a lot better if you just, like, called my mother, you know, a bad name. And it's just like that. So it's up and down, just like rejections and everything, you know. It's like, you know, we just got called for this movie from, you know, the LA Film Festival. They're like, full invitation, and then literally within the, you know, 24 hours, they're like, oh, you know, you're disqualified because you did another festival, you can't come in. So it's an up and down thing. Just get thick skin. Rejection is what just, it's
curveballs and rejection.
Yeah. Totally.
So you can plan all you want to plan, but that's, you know, you end up, like you said, not where you necessarily thought you were going to go, but you end up a lot of times in a good place also. It's,
you do.
A new way. Just, you're like, okay, so this is now the journey that it became.
Exactly. It's, you just don't know what, allow your film to take its life. And just like you said, like my most popular film that I feel that, you know, really kickstarted my career, didn't get into Sundance or didn't get to South by Southwest. And I was like, okay, it's over. Like, I can't, you know, how are we going to do it? And it actually went off and did a bunch of festivals and won awards like that. And Trevor called again and was just like, damn, I wish we would have programmed that film. But just didn't know, like, just, you know.
I think that's been kind of the journey for our film. Like, we didn't start at a big festival. We've been playing, you know, festivals in a lot of different cities, like around the U.S. And, you know, we didn't get it, like, while it was still, like, a rough cut, I was like, oh, I'm going to try to hurry the edit and, like, get it, like, a rough cut so I can, submit to, like, these big festivals in Europe over the summer. And it was just and I got a lot of rejection letters and I only started getting acceptances once it was, like, fully done. And I think there is, there's something, like, especially in the sound mix, there's something very subjective about sound that, like, even for me, having known the film, like, watching it before the sound mix and watching it at the sound mix, I was like, wow, now it seems like watching a real movie. Yeah. And before that, it felt like watching an edit. And I think that was a big shift.
Yeah.
5.1, like, sitting in the first time, it's like a surround mix. It's like the moment when I'm just, like, feel like crying.
Yeah.
Like, now I'm thinking about it, I'm like gonna cry. But it's like it feels alive. It's like has a heartbeat.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really true.
Anybody else? Yes, sir.
I am like so like a sponge. I like love like hearing all these awesome stories, seeing these awesome films are independent. But I'm trying to find out like where to watch them. And you mentioned, you know, you stream them. Where do you stream awesome like independent films all over the world?
Well, I mean, most streaming services like iTunes and stuff will have like a curated section where you can go look at independent films. There's also a streaming service called Fandor that's only independent films and art films. That's pretty cool. But a lot of the streaming services will have an independent section, and you can look at what's in there. And also, if you find an independent film that you like, they'll often give you recommendations of films that are similar. So you can kind of go down that rabbit hole.
You know that word, you know, straight to video? It's kind of gone now. Yeah. I don't never hear it used anymore. And that used to be really negative, right? You just went straight to video, and you had this connotation of, well, it must be bad, it didn't get a theatrical release. Now we have now it's all VOD, right? VOD, video on demand platforms, Google Plus, Netflix, you know, iTunes. And then, okay, great. And then how do you, you know, you have to go through brokers, aggregators to get to those people and then whatever reach they have. So you're signing licensing paperwork with somebody with no necessary guarantees. So, and a lot of times you get on those and then you're like, great, I'm on. You ever go to Netflix and somebody tells you about a movie and you go, you have to type it in to find it, right? It's not on there.
Yeah.
And I literally know from some people at aggregators that a lot of times it's executive phone call at Netflix to get, you know, which dramas are being shown, which is, you know, so it's there's that part of it, right? There's that playing the game part of it to try to, you know, And that's where playing festivals can help. You got laurels on it, you know, they're more apt to go, we like the movie, great, but where's your built-in marketing engine that we can, that helps us help you?
Yeah.
Right? So, but so it's a whole journey just for us to even get on these new platforms. It's great, it's exciting. There's a lot of new avenues for us to be out to get these VOD platforms, but there's a lot of people like us competing against each other.
It's so
quite
funny.
Frankly, to get on to them and get the best placement that we can get.
That asexual is A in parentheses, so it's at the top. And I swear, I swear that's why we have a distributor.
That comes
like,
right in the middle.
I had like a meeting with Film Buff, and the first thing they said was, it's A in a parentheses, so it's at the top.
Yeah.
And I was like, did you like the movie? I mean, they just were like, we want to sign you. And I was like, wow. So it's always at the top.
Do you have another question over there? Yes,
sir. As a new filmmaker, particularly in documentaries, what just looking at logistics, what part of the process would you say as a new filmmaker you definitely need to hire somebody else as opposed to you trying to do it yourself? Versus what parts of the process would you say this is something you can probably invest and learn in and do well? So which part should you invest in, and which part do you think you should learn in starting out? And I know you shouldn't know everything.
Well, that's a personal like skill set question. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know your skill set, but I think, well, if you have no skill set, then you gotta hire a lot of people. But you know, I think it's I think A, it's like knowing your skill set. Like, I'm not, you know, I can produce, I can do sound, I cannot shoot. So, you know, I knew that I needed that support. You know, like I shot a couple of interviews on my first film, and I watched them and they looked terrible and it was awful. But, you know, I think it's, it's kind of knowing your skill set. So, like, maybe in that situation, finding someone who is a shooter, who you have a relationship with, who, you know, might start to do things for you at, like, a really reduced rate or for free or whatever, you know, just to kind of, like, get the interviews in the can. So I knew I also had to hire an editor, and that's when we did a Kickstarter campaign because, you know, I could kind of work the shooting things in terms of favors with friends, and I would just produce something for somebody and then they would shoot for me, and I did that through production. And then once I got to, I knew we needed like money for the edit stage because I am not an editor. So so we brought on an editor at that stage. So I think it's really just kind of looking at what you can do, what you're good at, you know, because it's really important that your movie look good. It's really important. They're all, you know, all of these things are important. So figuring out what you can do and sitting down and going and kind of going from there. But partnerships are everything in terms of making projects, particularly in the documentary level.
I did a doc. Go ahead.
I was going to say the two places for me for doc, because I produce mostly nonfiction work, sound, like keep. Capturing sound like saves you in the edit because you can use sound as a connective tissue between so many things, and poor sound is not forgivable. Like a shaky camera in like a chaotic war zone, cool. If you can't hear what the guy is saying, like
that's true.
It doesn't work. So sound is super important, but I think editing is where, you know, editors are writers for nonfiction. And I think often in nonfiction filmmaking, like you just need someone to look from an outside perspective, and also in post, it's the most lucrative place for grant writing because you have footage. So you could actually use footage and kind of a teaser reel to bring on an editor. But an editor, I think, in nonfiction is such a key creative role. Mm-hmm. And if you're on set and you live that experience, it's sometimes very, very challenging because you're dealing with real people and real relationships to see them as characters in a film. And I think an editor brings that kind of third perspective in nonfiction that is vital, and you don't have the capacity to do it. Like you can't, even if you're a super skilled editor, like you can put together a cut, but you don't have the distance to see them as what they are on screen, which is a character in a film. You see them as humans, and which they are, and that's important too, and that kind of like human love and trust is valuable in nonfiction filmmaking. But there are like story decisions that need to be done that you need to have distance. And I think,
That makes sense.
Do we have another question? Yes.
My question was there a time that was like a low point for you, or the time that you thought you, like, this isn't for me, And what made you get out of that funk?
This morning over waffles.
Like, again, like, what time?
I was looking at the different majors that were offering at Cleveland State.
What made you get that spark back, or just telling yourself personally, like, no, this is for me. This is like a little rough patch in the road.
I think it's a series of highs and lows. It's just the reality of it. And you're trying to manage your own personal psychology and expectations, and it's very difficult because there's so many unknowns. And I think there's a lot of second guessing, especially as you get older and start families, and it's such a demanding, unpredictable, world. I mean, I have a 7-year-old son, and I'm very aware of that it's not easy to keep that balanced, with the unpredictability of it. So for me, it's just a constant. It's a constant guessing of, should I be doing this or not, quite frankly. And then, you come to, that's why I think also playing festivals and meeting. I would say, you come to festivals to commiserate and then celebrate a little bit, right? Kind of that journey, and it's that celebration and meeting other filmmakers and commiserating with them,
There's free beer.
Yeah, there's free beer. There's usually a beer tent.
Yeah.
That's what you're playing me.
I agree. I feel like the way I say it, it's like, if it's not hard, or I like how you put it, challenging. If it's not supremely challenging, then you're not doing it right. If it's coming easy or something like that, there's probably something just going on. Or unless, you are, such an extreme talent, which then, God bless. But, it's like, even great athletes and stuff like that, you hear from it, it's like they all have the hardest time, it's just not easy. So it's the love of the game. I mean, it really is. You have to be committed, and it's all aspects. I mean, and all again, like the emotional roller coaster ride, it's hard, but you need the thick skin. If you don't have thick skin in this, if you're not ready for rejection constantly, or, people critique your work. Like, I'll sit there and it's like, it's not like if you do something most other fields, nobody's really critiquing. Like, this is like people really critique your work. It's like, stand there naked, and I'm gonna like really just put every flaw that you have, and it's really, then you. I've got to a point where I just don't even read stuff anymore. I just don't, but that's, if you're gonna lose that spark easily, it's not. Then it's. I mean, I think everybody here can tell you it's not an easy field, and I wish I can say different, but it's hard from the moment you start writing to getting rejection from distributors or nobody. It really is. It's a great. There's a lot of love there.
Do you have another question? Yes, over there.
For those of you who are, I know Anna said she's into a documentary. For those of you that are into fiction writing, and fiction film, I understand, Angela, you're getting into that. How much is an independent, smaller filmmakers? Are you interested in just writing your own stuff as opposed to getting stuff from people like me who are screenwriters? I'm just wondering, and how do you find stuff? I know what the big houses look for and the agents and all that, but how do you come into material? And, or are you interested in material as opposed to writing and directing it yourself?
Well, for me personally, I'm a writer and a director, so I have a whole list of stuff that I want to write for myself to do. But I also, so for me, I'm not, personally, I probably am not a person. I'm like, send me your scripts. But I have friends who are directors who don't write, and they, so they need to find material. And then it's really about like finding something that already exists that they can see, that connects with them and their sort of sensibility and vision. Because it is like, making a film is like a multi-year time commitment. So whether you're writing it yourself or you're finding a script, like you have to like really believe that like the next like 3 years of your life, you can keep that passion for that project. Do you guys have any thoughts on that?
Do I understand that you're asking that how screenwriters like you can get in touch with independent filmmakers like them? So that's
our question. One, are there these independent directors, producers, themselves interested in outside stuff.
Do you look for it? Like, do you guys look for it?
I do both. I do fiction and nonfiction. Oh, okay. But I just, after Sundance, I got management and agent as a fiction director, so they are sharing scripts, but I also write. So it's like, I think for me, the reason why I want to look at both is because I want to make this a sustainable career for me. And the reality is, if you're birthing your own projects, that multi-year cycle means you're doing work, you know, if things are going well, like every 3-4 years, you know, and then you supplement it through, like Claire does, with short content, music videos, commercials. You could also supplement that with other feature work where you're collaborating with another writer. So there's many different models, I think, that for directors to make, to continue to work, because it's not just about money, it's also about flexing your muscles and learning. Like, you could learn something on a commercial, you know. But I'm doing both reading, but I also read like articles constantly. That's actually my joy, is reading nonfiction, thinking about them in a fiction way, but reading nonfiction short form articles. And you can, like, you can option articles too.
Which is big now.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. It's like, so anything basically you can option, which is crazy. But I think that there are writers who also have managers and agents who are just constantly sending their work out to other people. Mm-hmm. There's lots of models. So.
Do we have another? Yes.
I have a question about the casting process. Like, for example, Charles, I know that you went to LA to get your 5 principles. So if you guys who have done that versus casting locally and then making that decision if you're going to go to New York or LA and setting up those auditions, like what that process?
Yeah, for me, there's 35 speaking roles in the film that I have here at the festival, which actually is a lot when I looked at it for a really small independent film. But I knew I wanted to do, as a part of my model, I wanted to bring in the top 5 leads from Los Angeles. So, you could, as a producer, you could call the agents and managers directly and try to go that way. I decided to get a casting director on board because I knew that, they would, somebody was going to carry more weight than I would by picking up the phone. But that's an expense you have to look at, right? And then, so I literally was knocking on doors and making phone calls and using people that I'd met through working, to get to somebody, Barbara McCarthy, who really got behind the script. She's got the inroads to CAA, to UTA, to William Morris, that I would never have gotten, for just me making a small film in Northeast Ohio. But it involved convincing her, and then you're ironing out her contract with her agent and our lawyer, and that takes a couple weeks, But then once Barbara got on board, then we just did casting sessions in Los Angeles, and really it was for the female leads in my film, it was overwhelming the amount of females that were showing up, because there's really strong female roles in my film, and it wasn't so much as the lead male role, which was really interesting, and I was like, wow, I can't believe, but then there's, you get these casting sheets that come in that say, here's a list of people, they're available. Who's available from the major agency? Available. And then there's a column right next to that where it says offer only, as in we're not going to come read for you, make us an offer and we'll look at it. And if the offer is big enough, then we might read the script, yeah, exactly. Okay? So what I learned through this process in going through this film was that, the casting director put us on this, window of, when you're signing that contract, it's this many weeks that you have for their time, because they're not going to infinitely cast your film. So, you get going and everything moves slower than you want it to, and you're kind of in panic mode. And we actually ended up lapsing over that time, but we had built up a good rapport, and it was like, all right, we're still going to go through this, because I hadn't found the lead that I wanted yet. And my lead actor in the film ultimately got the script because he was at lunch with another CAA agent. Somebody walked by and said, hey, this is getting passed around CAA, and they really like it, and handed it to him, and he went home and read it. I was sitting in a parking lot at CVS drinking a Gatorade because I was really depressed and thirsty. And my phone rang and said, hey, somebody just got the script and they want to meet. And I'm like, well, I'm flying out tomorrow, but I'll stick around. So called back and said, meet at the Culver Hotel in Culver City at 8:00. And we sat there for like 3 hours drinking coffee and talking about, the two things, the creative side of it, and then how it was actually going to logistically happen. Because I really had to sell these people on the fact that this was, as much as this somebody might like the story, they do not want to show up to amateur hour, you know, as we call it, a shit show, basically, yeah. You know. So so that was a big part of it, you know, and then that goes back to what team members I already had on board, and then they're going to look those folks up and see what credits they have and they've done before, and they go, okay, you know, the sniff test tells me that there's professionals associated with this, right? But even when they land and they come and they look, and you know, there's the big, okay, is this really real, you know? So, but that's how my journey was for this one. I think every project's a little different in how it comes together, but that's how this one came together.
Another question we have? Anybody else? Yes.
Anna, I believe you just mentioned you can option an article. Can you explain what that meant in the process?
Yeah, so optioning is basically paying a certain amount of money for the rights to creatively exploit other people's intellectual property or creative property. So that
spoken with, like a producer.
So basically, you all know, like, you know, books like Harry Potter was optioned by a studio, by Warner Brothers. They own the rights. They hired writers that, who they paid to create content with that. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes nowadays, novels are pre-optioned, so they're the rights for them are already secured before they even hit like the bookshelf.
Yeah.
And now you can do that with life rights for famous athletes like Misty Copeland. Like, her life rights are probably secured, you know, through her agent somehow, you know, for a story. Or you can do that with a nonfiction article. Maybe a journalist spent 12 months researching like water kind of poisoning at a specific place, and they've met those characters, they've done the research, so they own some sort of creative rights to the frame of that story. It's not like you couldn't make a story about that, but framing it with those characters, with that point of view, that's the creative work that they did, so you would pay a fee. And normally how that goes, if you're independent, you can do this without having an agent or a manager or a studio attached. You option it for a period of time, and then you can, if you within that period of time don't create content, the option releases out into the public, or you can pay to renew it for another 5 years or 10 years. So there's, you should have a lawyer involved on either side of this. It's a complicated thing, but it's also an exciting thing because I think you can look for inspiration in so many different ways. And I think especially in the nonfiction to fiction, like even as a, on the documentary side, work that we created, full feature-length documentaries can be optioned to be turned into fiction films.
Yeah,
so like there's, and that could be an exciting way to finance your next project. Mm-hmm. If that's something that you think is worthwhile, there's so many ways to share ideas. And I think there's a lot of negative ways for those interactions to fall through. But yeah, so it's the business, pure business side of it, but I would say either if you're interested in something or have something you might want to option to be created into film, to talk at first to legal counsel.
One more question.
Yes, speaking of options, does it also apply to, let's say, something you want to adopt, like F. Scott Fitzgerald or Vanity Fair, something that was made in the 17th, 18th century? Do you still have to worry about optioning that if it's, you know, public domain?
It really depends. You can do a very simple copyright or title or license search on famous material. So, like, I imagine if you were talking about F. Scott Fitzgerald, like, those, they may not be available. But it's not like, I'm not talking about licensing, like using a classical music piece in your film that's in the public domain. Like, those are different rights. Everything has rights. That if creative material that you're using in any way, if it's old, it doesn't necessarily mean that nobody has the rights to exploit it. And sometimes it means it's just been around long enough that it would have been swooped up. I mean, you can research that, and there's a national search, but then you can just look at the publisher, you can contact them, they have a rights person. So that's, if it's a book, it's very easy because you'll be able to get all the contact information if you look on that.
Kind of, so that's international.
Yeah.
So if I'm looking at something in Eastern Europe or in Asia,
I would look, it's basically whoever published it had a rights contract in place when they put that work out to make. So if it's a book that's been published, someone was making money or put money into putting out onto the world, and they're the first person that I would contact in order to start researching that. But it can be, yeah, it's these rights and creative rights are all over the world. And when you write a contract, you write in the universe, actually. That's the legal term.
Yes. And there's like a lot, I mean, there's, you can, you know, like there's, you know, like the rights also like kind of go, there's rights on top of the rights, you know, totally. Because like, it's like you take a movie like The Night Stalker, you know, David Fincher did The Night Stalker with was it Mark Ruffalo and Jake Gyllenhaal. But if you notice, there's like 20 other movies called The Night Stalker because that case like that, you can make a movie. You could, like a serial killer, you could make a movie. That's what you see, like, you know, the Richard Ramirez story. Like, you can, those rights are free because of the crime. I don't know exactly.
It's a public figure.
It's a public, yeah.
So,
but like David Fincher got the rights to the specific book.
Correct.
Right. That he based his movie off. But then when that movie was coming out, you noticed that there was like five other movies called The Night Stalker that came out. So there's a lot, it gets kind of a little bit mind-boggling too.
At the end of the day, people sue people even when stuff is.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, it's lawyers' interpretation of, well, of yeah. what is on the page and another lawyer's interpretation. So you can go through fair use laws and dock this, that, and the other thing. And at the end of the day, somebody wants to sue you and you're going to go in front of a judge or whatever, they're going to be interpreted. And
well, because there's a whole thing like that. You know, it's like when Transformers was coming out, there's like that one company was the Asylum where it was like Transmorphers was coming out right, like week right before, like straight to DVD, you know. It's funny.
Let's thank our panelists. They took out time to come and speak to us.